We'll see about that. I'll not be put off by any warning.
Thus Blanche Fleur, seeing that Percival is eager to do just what she wants him to, denies her real wishes in order to increase his eagerness. In this she is clever, having put him in mind to do what she strongly blames him for.
Who sent you here, lad? Tell me what errand you're on. Have you come looking for peace or a fight?
You tell me first what you're doing here, and why you've wrought such havoc in this company, and killed its knights.
I want that castle evacuated, and its keep surrendered to me this very day, for it's held out against me too long. And then my lord Clamadieu will have the monopoly and the profit he seeks, and the maiden to boot.
Damn this claim, and the one who uttered it. On the contrary, you two vandals will have to renounce every demand you make of her.
Now, by St. Peter, this is a lot of nonsense you're telling me. Have a care, for it often happens that the one who's not guilty of a foolish act pays the penalty for it.
Ongigeron's taunt stings Percival's pride, so he lowers his lance and the two charge at each other as fast as their horses can carry them. So fierce is the impact that their lances fly into splinters and they continue their fight on foot. The struggle lasts a long time and many stout blows are exchanged until Ongigeron falls. Standing over him, with the heat of battle still coursing through his veins, Percival raises his sword, but then he remembers Sir Gorneman's advice to show mercy.
Good Sir Knight, don't be so brutal as to refuse me mercy.
As God is my witness, so be it.
If you have a lord who's done you some service, send me to him, and I shall surrender to him as his captive.
You will go as prisoner to King Arthur, and you will greet the king for me and offer yourself in his service.
So Ongigeron is sent packing to Arthur's court, and there is much rejoicing that night at the castle with Blanchefleur. Yet Ongigeron was only the first wave lapping against the lover's fate, for now comes his lord, Clamadieu, hot-headed and furious in pursuit of the besieged castle and damsel. He sends in reinforcements, but they are cut down by the arrows from the battlements. Then decimated by the portcullis falling upon them, Clamadieu finds himself separated from his men, alone within the fortress's walls. Enraged and obstinate, Clamadieu challenges Percival to single combat, another fight to the death. And, once more, heedless of his lover's blandishments not to go, Percival rides out to fight on her behalf. And, once more, their shields are smashed, their lances shattered, and after a long, even contest with their swords, Clamadieu also is forced to ask for mercy. He is granted it on the same conditions as before and must set off immediately for King Arthur's court to surrender in Percival's name. My dear and noble knight, now you have freed my people and saved me from certain death by my own hand. Our celebrations and my happiness would be complete and perfect if you will now consent to stay with me here.
Alas, my sweet lady. Please believe me that my heart would wish for nothing more, but I must now continue on my journey back home to find my mother, for I am concerned that she will be worrying herself to death about my safety. I promise I shall return when I have assured her of my well-being.
And so, next morning, despite Blanche Fleur's sorrow and her people's pleas, Percival sets off into the wild forest once again. It was always understood in olden times that a journey is not just a journey, but a story with a purpose and question that must be discovered. The wild woods are the labyrinth, and the way out always different to the way in. What what do we find at the center of the labyrinth? The place of overlap between the worlds. Sometimes we stumble unaware upon this space, like a clearing in the forest, and recognize, perhaps for the first time, where we have always lived.